Good morning, everybody. Morning, Jubilee. Lots of room up front for some worship.
The whole wide world, it comes straight from
of all his love. We are moving over the earth, that is his glory. We are moving like a flood of all his love. We are moving over the earth, that is his glory. Cover the earth, oh, 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 oh. Cover the earth, oh, 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 oh. Cover the earth. To get carried away.
Warm. is from within. There's a warm wind blowing and it's blowing still, and a fire that is filling me. It's filling me with you. There's a bright light shining in the heart of the universe. The love is flashing me, taking us to the edge of the dawn. You're taking us up, 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 taking us up. Hope is like a lion, roars on the horizon, calling us home. Oh, 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 oh. Calling us home. Oh, 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 oh.
Taking us up, up, up,
taking us up. Love is like a
we'll be right back.
closer we get, Lord, the stronger we feel your love. The closer we get, Lord, the stronger we feel your love for us. You want us to close, you want us to come closer, you want us to be right by your side, leaning on your chest, oh Father. We're coming closer, we're coming closer, so close you
sing of your love forever. see light. In your light we 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 see light. You're filling us with your light. Darkness disappears. Darkness disappears. Ooh. Oh. Of love, find myself, find myself under the shadow of your wings. Here in the secret place of love, find myself under the shadow of your wings. Here in the secret place of love.
Thank you.
yeah.
There's healing in your wings, healing in your wings, healing in your wings, oh Lord. Everything, everything,
there's healing in your wings,
healing in your wings, healing in your wings, oh Lord. There's healing in your wings, healing in your wings, healing in your wings, oh Lord, oh Lord, oh He's the Father of lights. In him there's no darkness at all. Smooth operator, smooth operator.
Jesus, wow. Well, wonderful to sense the magnificence of God in this place and just the freedom that comes in the glory. It's nothing like it. Just find someone, give them a squeeze or a handshake, and just bless them and then be seated.
Good morning, Jubilee. If I can ask you to find your seats. I think God has a sense of humor because every time I'm up for notices these days, I just am overwhelmed by his presence and his goodness. So I'm going to try and get through the notices again today. It was exactly the same a few weeks ago. I love it. Wouldn't have it any other way. So hopefully by now you've found a seat and you've stopped your conversations and you're listening and you're looking this way, because I've got some really awesome announcements this week that I'd love for you to hear. I just want to welcome those of you who are here for the first time, and welcome. I hope you feel welcomed. I hope you feel loved. And just want to let you know that next door we have a visitors lounge, and we'd love for you to come next door. There'll be some people out there with some food and some coffee, and would love to get to know you better. So if I can have the team take up the tithe and offering this morning, it's my beautiful home group whom we love. It's our family. So thank you guys. The Create School this Wednesday is at 5:30, followed by the Harp and Bowl at 7:30. And then this week, how exciting is Brian Simmons? So that starts this Thursday night at 7 p.m. It's called Touching Eternity, which I love because I feel like I was doing that today in the worship. And he will go until Saturday, the 21st. And then he'll be at all three services on the Sunday as well, which is so cool. So why don't you invite some people? Why don't you invite some friends, invite some family, invite some strangers, why not? And ask them to come to the services on Sunday. And that means that there will be no healing rooms this Saturday either because of Brian Simmons. And I'm just going to quickly share something that I was seeing in the worship today, if I can. You know, I often hear about the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And this morning, I saw so clearly God put a key in my hand, and it was multifaceted. And in that vision, I said to God, but it's keys, Lord, plural. It's the keys to the kingdom. And he said so clearly to me, it's a master key. You have the master key to heaven. And I said, well, show me what that looks like, Lord. Because in my mind, keys open doors. And so he started showing me the doors that we can all open with the master key. And the first door, I saw finances and riches. Just as I opened the door, it fell out of the door. Just the biggest amount of riches, because they don't fit in the room in heaven. They're just waiting for us to unlock the doors. And then he opened another door and I saw body parts fall out. I saw healing fall out. I saw spines fall out. I saw new lungs fall out. I saw a pelvis fall out. And I could see all these new body parts falling out because we dared to unlock the door in heaven. And one door I unlocked and I saw cancer fall out. And I asked about that one and he said, "You have the keys to unlock the healing to cancer in bodies." I unlocked another door and I saw the glory of God just fall out of this door to say, "You have the key to unlock the glory as well." And there was another door that I unlocked and I was standing on the edge of space. That's what it looked like. And he said, "You have the keys to unlock the mysteries of the heavens, of the universe." And then I said, "Show me more, Lord. What other doors are there that we can unlock with this master key?" And he said, "You're only limited by your imagination. You're only limited by your imagination." He said it to me 3 times. "You're only limited by your imagination as to what this master key can unlock." And so I hope that encourages you today, that we all have the master key and that we can unlock any of those doors that are in heaven. So whatever it is that you are believing for, I encourage you to believe that you hold the key and that you can unlock the door that you need in your life right now. Oh, and one other cool door, I opened it and manna fell out. I saw manna from heaven, fresh bread fall out. And I thought, "I'll have that." I'm not really sure what that means just yet, but I'll have whatever's behind the door. So on that note, I think I finished all the notices. So I'll ask the kids to go through to kids' church this morning. And let's welcome Fini as he brings the word.
Thank you, Lord. Oh. How many could feel the presence while that word was coming? Well, that's for those, if you've got a spine or a hip problem or a lung problem or a need for finance this morning, we're going to pray for every one of those areas because there's activation. When the word comes, there's the activation. So as the word comes, you activate. You say, "That's for me, Lord." And you might receive the healing right now in your seat. Or you may need someone to agree with you in prayer. Either way, there's breakthrough coming to hips, lungs, pelvises, spines, manna. Don't know what that looks like, but I'm very open to manna too. That'd be very cool. Thank you, Jesus. If you're wondering where my lovely wife is, she's ministering at Grace River this morning, which is a church that we planted with Mick in Newcastle about 2 to 3 years ago, and she did a 4-hour kind of mini conference on the prophetic yesterday, and today she's ministering in the morning service, and we'll be back for our evening service. So how cool is that? It's nice to be touching different places. So if you turn with me to the book of Luke this morning, I'd like to bring you a word that I feel God's given me for you all. How many feel encouraged this morning? He's a smooth operator, our God. It's lovely when just we just make the secular sacred. It's like what we say is holy will be holy, you know. We'll make it holy. And just happens. Might never do it like that again, but just enjoy the moment. Luke 5. Holy. Luke 5 from verse 1. "Now it occurred that while the people pressed upon Jesus to hear the message of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the Sea of Galilee, and he saw two boats drawn up by the lake, but the fishermen had gone down from them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, the one that belonged to Simon, he requested him to draw away a little from the shore. Then he sat down and continued to teach the crowd from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and lower your nets for a haul." And Simon Peter answered, "Master, we've toiled all night," and in the Amplified it says, exhaustingly, "and caught nothing in our nets, but on the ground of your word, I will lower the nets again." Something of what happened this morning is that some of you have trusted God for healing in your spine or in your lungs. Maybe you've been a smoker all your life, and you've said, "Lord, can you renew my lungs?" Well, Lord's saying to you today, well, those lungs were for you. God's going to give you a new set of lungs. So you can be smoking for 20 years and get a new set of lungs. I don't recommend it. If you're smoking today, just stop it, all right? So you don't need a new set of lungs. But if you have been, how many know there's grace for our mistakes? There's grace for the things that we've made mistakes in. And if you've made that mistake of having an unhealthy lifestyle, whether it's to do with lungs or some other area of your body, God's got new body parts for you today. That's the word of the Lord. When the word of the Lord came, that's when the activation came. So they were starting to argue with Jesus, which is often the case. We've worked all night. We're fishermen. We know more than you. It's like Jesus is like, "Oh, if only you knew. If only you knew. I created the fish. I can arrange fish. I know where the fish are. I can call fish into your nets. Why are you wailing and worrying about your future and about your finance, about your provision? Because I know what you need." That's what he was saying to him. "I know what you need." And so Peter says, "At your word, I will do it." So that's the important part is, number one, you got to have Jesus in your boat. If you have a crisis, if you need something, make sure he's in your boat. And if you're a person here this morning and you found your way into church and you're like, "Oh, people are a bit excited, a bit, you know, a bit hyped up." No, we're not hyped up. We're just happy. And it didn't take any drugs or alcohol to get us that way. It came straight from heaven, from the river of God. We took a big drink and we got happy. And I have no apology for that or no embarrassment about it, because it's free. It didn't cost me anything. It's got no hangover associated with it. You don't have to crush it, sniff it, smoke it. You don't have to inhale it at all. You just got to receive it from heaven because it's free. But if you don't know that, if Jesus isn't in your boat, you can receive him today. Today, the Bible says today is a day of salvation. Don't harden your heart. Just say yes to God. You can say it yes right now in your seat. You see, because it's just saying, "I receive that. I need that." You lean into God. When God speaks, you lean into him and you receive the breakthrough. And so what Jesus was talking about to his disciples was a principle for the future. Is that you fished all night, you've caught nothing, that's okay. It's not like that's what you do, you fish all night. There was nothing wrong with what they were doing. They're doing repetitive things endlessly. They probably tried this place and they thought, "Hey, James, let's go over to that reef. Remember that reef where we got fish 3 weeks ago? Let's try that reef." They probably traveled through the night across the ocean, across that sea, and they tried every different place and didn't come up with anything. And there's no sin in hard work. There's no sin in failure. To fail is not to sin. They didn't sin. They just worked all night and got nothing out of it. They tried everything, every prayer. They pled the blood. They prayed in tongues. They cast out the demons that prevent fish from coming. They tried everything. They got a holy shower cap. They prayed. They called the prayer hotline. You know. They sowed seed faith into some overseas televangelist ministry. They tried everything, and still nothing. And you see, that's the place some people find themselves when they fished all night but caught nothing. There's nothing wrong with you. Nothing wrong with you. You haven't failed. You haven't failed. Just because you haven't got the catch you've been looking for doesn't mean you failed. Breakthrough's just there. You see, these disciples did nothing wrong. They were like, "Well, we've done it all night and we think we know best, but there's always a but. There's but Jesus. There's always a what if. There's always a suddenly." And that's what God does. He comes. They didn't know that Jesus can arrange fish. And such a large catch was had by them that it took two boats to bring the net in. They were stunned. Peter, in fact, said, "Jesus, go away from me. I'm a sinful man. What you're doing is freaking me out. It's like I'm not worthy for you to be in my boat." And Jesus is like, "Well, actually, I want to make you rich." Because you see, they made their living from fishing. If you gave me a boat full of fish, well, yeah, I could eat a few and I'd share a few. And I'd give them to my neighbors. But after a while, I'm like, "Well, do you have any money rather, Jesus? I'd prefer cash. Cash would be good. I don't need fish. You know what I mean? Don't give me a voucher. Give me the cash." And that's, Jesus knows what you need. And it's the principle of provision he's talking about. It's the principle of when you've done all you know, what do you do? That's what this message is about. When you've done all you know what to do, what do you do? Well, if you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6, I'll give you some more ideas about this. It's an important topic. Ephesians 6 verse 10 says, "Finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." Say, take your stand. There is a stand that each of us has to take. Doesn't mean you take a grandstand. Didn't say take your grandstand. He wasn't talking about a soapbox. It's not talking like wear a Christian, have a t-shirt, stand on a corner, look weird. You know, it's not that kind of take your stand. It's just taking an internal stand. I'm taking a stand for righteousness. I'm taking a stand for justice. I'm taking a stand for purity. I'm taking a stand for integrity. I'm taking a stand for Christ. Does that mean, you know how many say you take a stand? You don't have to advertise it. You don't have to wear a t-shirt. You don't have to proclaim it. You've got to be it. You be the stand that you take. It says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood. We're not fighting rulers, people in power. The rulers in power are not the real power. We pray for our leaders. How many of you are praying for our leaders right now? They need prayer. Every day we should be praying for our leaders, those in authority, those that God's given us to govern, because we want to live peaceable lives. We've got to pray for our leaders. We've got to love our leaders too. We've got to send out lots of love, because it's not happening right now, mostly in our nation. But I won't go there. Our struggle isn't against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. And it goes on to give us some advice about it. How do we know when we're in a struggle? How do we know? You'll know. Not everybody will know, but we'll know. You see, if we were involved in a fracas, you know how many of us know what a fracas is? It's this actual physical scuffle. Some sort of, "Hey, you push me, I'll push you." That's a fracas. That's something that you can see. And that's obvious. You see a person like scuffle. Well, if the devil arrived as some sort of, you know, image that we could wrestle and tie up and call a paddy wagon and get him taken away, we'd say, "Ah, I won." No, it isn't. It's far more subtle. It's actually going on in here. The struggle is not in here. The struggle is in here. And if there are thoughts of accusation, thoughts of intimidation, thoughts of suicide, thoughts of worthlessness, that's where the wrestling is. So you can be driving your car looking like a very upright citizen. Actually, you're wrestling in your mind. There's thoughts. There's things going on. That's the place you got to win the battle, because the battle is not here. It's up here. That's why we don't have to worry about, you know, warring with people. Arguments, pretensions. You never win an argument with someone. Never. My father taught me, if a man convinced against his will remains unconvinced still. So I don't argue with people. People are like, "I believe this, I believe this." I'm like, "Awesome. I don't care what you believe." So I'm like, "Yeah, you said this, you said that." I said, "Yeah, I believe that. And I've changed my position over the years on different theologies. I might change some more because I'm growing. I'm growing in wisdom. But I'm also, humility says, you can have your belief and opinion about things. I don't care. As long as it doesn't impact on other people and you don't try and force them to believe what you believe and you want to argue with people about this law and grace and end times and this is how it's actually going to work, just don't argue. You can't argue with someone who won't argue. You say, "Do you love Jesus?" "Yes." "Awesome. We're neighbors in heaven.
I don't want to win against you because I'm not struggling against people. I'm struggling against rulers and authorities, and God's going to show us the weapons that we have, which are more powerful than any weapon on the earth. You don't need an atom bomb. You just need a few very, very sharp words from heaven. You need a song of the Lord. You need things that will take you away into new places and new victories. That's what God's got for us. And our struggle is against rulers, authorities, powers. It says this, so he says, therefore put on the full armor of God, and we might talk about that tonight, but so that when the day of evil comes, it doesn't say if. When the day of evil comes. Now, sometimes we're like, why did I get a day of evil against me? Well, you're just a believer. Just because you woke up. And the day of evil comes. So, oh, not the day of evil. Not the day of evil. Anything but the day of evil. It's not that bad. Because here's of Jesus Christ. He is, in Colossians 2:15, he has openly displayed. He's overcome the princes of the power of the air and made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in the cross. He has disarmed them. So the day of evil is not a day of terror. It's not a day of, oh, I've got evil against me. Of course you have. You woke up. But he has disarmed the powers and rulers, authorities, and made a public spectacle of them. So although we struggle against them, because we're living in a fallen age, we're living in a fallen generation, there is a battle. There is a struggle. It's a struggle in your mind. It's a struggle to stay positive. It's a struggle to believe that you're worthy. It's a struggle to believe in the goodness of God. It's a struggle to believe you're going to break through. When you've fished all night, you think, fishing sucks. Really? It's like, you're like, I need a new career. Who wants to be a fisherman? I think that Simon and Peter and his brothers were like, how come Luke has got all the money? I wish I was a doctor. Really? Look at Simon, the tax collector. He's got money. And yeah, we are fishing and poor. And you want to give up. You want to quit what you're doing. You want to quit because there's always a, you know, the grass is greener on the other side. The grass is only greener over the septic tank. That's where it's greener. Come on. Those of you who haven't lived in the country, you don't even know what I'm talking about. Let me put it this way, just subtly for the children here. We have waterborne sewage in the city, but in the country they have septic tanks. That's where it goes. All right, the stuff. That's where it goes. And it helps everything grow really well. So beware the greener grass. You can see, because sometimes we want a better life. We want someone else's life. We look at them and think, oh, if I just had their life. Don't envy anybody. We don't know what their struggles are. We don't know how they got there. And actually, it's none of our business. Never envy somebody else's life. Just say, Lord, I want to have the best life I can have. I want to live my life. I don't want to live a life wondering. I keep telling people, see, Fini, how are you doing? I say, I'm living the dream. And you say, Fini, but you know, this hasn't gone and this hasn't happened yet. Absolutely. But I'm not waiting to live the dream. I'm not waiting for some magical, mystical moment to make me live the dream. Someone else must make me live the dream. No, I'm living my dream today. Today's my dream. Today I'm thankful for what I have, where I live, who's in my life. I'm thankful for you. I'm thankful that I know many of you. I know you personally. I'm honored to know you. Your faith inspires me. You see, I look at Abraham. He believed for 25 years, but he also screwed up big time. He was immoral. He lied. He cheated. Slept with his servant girl. I mean, hello, where does it end? But I admire him. Many of you have not done any of those things. I admire you more than Abraham, to be honest. Come on. Some of you have just walked the narrow road of faith for years and years. You're better than Abraham. I got much more love and honor for you because I know you. I know your struggles. Because it says here, having done everything to stand. That's what it says. Comma. I know we've got a full stop in the NIV. But the commas and full stops are put there by interpreters and redactors, people who rewrote it. They're like, I think we should put a full stop here. Let's read it like this. Having done everything to stand your ground, stand firm. Say, having done everything to stand, stand. Stand. So people might ask you, so what are you doing with your life? Standing. No, what are you actually doing? You know, what are you doing to get this breakthrough? You need this breakthrough. You haven't broken through. I know. I'm standing. I'm a fisherman. I've caught no fish, but I love fishing. Because the fish are coming. The breakthrough's coming. Could be today. Could be tomorrow. I don't know. Don't care. See, there's some things I've been believing God for 19 years that I haven't yet seen. And I was reminded of them this week, actually. I was thinking, well, Lord, we haven't seen that yet. Just some very, very clear things where God himself spoke to us, audible voice, a vision from heaven, 19 years ago. Well, for Abraham, it's 25 years. For me, it's 19 years. I haven't yet seen some of the things God's promised us when we came to Sydney, eastern suburbs, we've got. We're like living in that dream. But some of them, we're living in the dream by faith. We're living the dream by faith. We're not living the actual dream. We're living the dream by faith. Because we haven't yet seen the fulfillment of the promise. I don't care. Because I'm standing. I want to be somebody who people look at and they say, he stood. Man, he stood. Look at his marriage. Look at his children. Look at the fruit of his life. There's fruit on the vine. God's looking for fruit. I'm looking for fruit as well. He looks for fruit. I don't have a problem with that. I look for fruit. Don't you look for fruit? Come on, not fruit cakes, fruit. The word stand is the word to keep your place. Keep your place. It has the implication of fidelity, faithfulness. One wife, one husband, one Lord, one master, one Savior. Not meddling with other gods. Not, you see, often what happens is you get disappointed. You're like, yeah, God, we believed you. Fished all night. People told us to tithe. They told us to do this, and we did that, and it didn't work. Yeah. And then you become unfaithful. You start to chase other things. You start to invest and look into other gods, other ways of doing things. Because that didn't work. Let's try something else. Like, let's try an Ishmael. And that's just a worse thing than before. All God says to you is, just stand. Be faithful. The word fidelity comes from the word faithfulness. Just be faithful. One husband, one wife, one Lord, one Savior, one baptism, one hope. Amen. There's no plan B. Now, Lord, how long have you been standing? All my life, really. I've been standing all my life. Some things I've seen, some things I haven't seen. Some things I saw more of when I was younger than I'm seeing now. I don't get it. But I'm not in charge. I'm like, oh, Finny, you know, you're not doing it. I know. I don't know. I was more effective in healing when I was 18 than what I am now. I have no idea why. But I'm a much better pastor and husband and lover than I was when I was 18. So I'll take this. Amen. Come on. Shabbat. Hebrews 12:1. I think something slipped out there. Hebrews, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great... If you missed it, you needed to miss it. You're too young. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance. Say perseverance. Perseverance. Make friends with Percy. Percy's your friend. He should be your best friend. Who's your best friend? Percy. Perseverance. And what are we running? It says, run with perseverance the race marked out for us. You see, this is not the study to surf. This is not like we're competing against 70,000 other people, and some of them are excellent runners, some of them are fit, and I'm unfit. I don't know if I can run against them. Well, let me just set you free right now. You are not running against anyone else. No one else. Just run your race. Because it's been marked out for you. I'm like, Lord, I don't do this. I haven't done that. You know, I've got that. Doesn't matter. Run your race. You get the prize if you run your race. You don't get a prize if you beat James. Amen. Anyone can beat James. But you won't beat Jordan, trust me. You know, you always just say you want your sons to overtake you. Well, he took it literally. I used to. So it's summertime, we're running from Coogee to Bondi and back, and it's about 15 Ks, and he starts off. I'm like, he's going to slow down sooner or later, and I'll catch him. I just never caught him. I'm still trying to catch him. So he says, run with Percy, the race marked out for us, fixing us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. Say, fixing your eyes on Jesus. So what do you do when you fished all night and caught nothing? What do you do when you're running the race and you haven't yet won the prize? You fix your eyes on Jesus. At the end of the day, it's His words I'm looking for. Yes. I want to hear Him say, well done, Fini, good and faithful servant. I don't mind the encouragement of people. I love people's encouragement, and I love encouraging people when they've done something and it just touches me. I always encourage people. But ultimately, I want to hear His encouragement because I'm doing it actually for Him. I serve people as a reflection of who God is. That's what leadership does. They lay down their lives for people. But I want to hear Him thank me one day. I want to hear Him say, well done. It says, for the joy, He's the perfecter and pioneer of our faith. It says, for the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. You see, you never have to endure the cross that Jesus did. But He's our great high priest, and He's our great encouragement because He endured more than you and I have to. So as a man, not as God, His divinity was restrained in His humanity. He was God. He could have called a legion. He could have had that pressure lifted. But He knew if He did that, He would be taking away the victory that you and I needed. We needed Him to win the keys of death, the grave, Hades, the pressure when it wants to, everything inside of you screaming, Lord, not my will, but yours be done. Take this cup from me. I cannot cope anymore. When you get to the end of your tether, you say, I cannot cope anymore. You think of the words of Jesus. It says He sweated drops of blood. I haven't been there. I've sweated. I've been in excruciating pressure at times in my life, but I've never sweated drops of blood. Why? Because He hasn't called me to carry His cross. He's called me to carry my cross. Come on. And my cross isn't a wooden cross. Come on. He's called me to carry a cross that I can carry. It's the will of God for my life. And for me, it's included changing nations and leaving family. It's included laying down my life. It's included some financial losses. It's included some sacrifices in terms of my time. Come on. But it's a price I can afford because God called me to take up my cross. And I do it willingly because it says He took up His cross for the joy set before Him. He wasn't like, I got to carry this cross. This is terrible. No, the cross was His victory. When the hordes of hell thought they had Him in the grave, well, there was just 3 days and there was coming back a victory. Easter was coming. Come on. Come on. What begins on Friday only ends on Sunday. Come on, because there's a victory coming. There's a resurrection coming. What looks like defeat is just the beginning of victory, actually. And people think, man, you should be so depressed. You did this, that happened. No, Sunday's coming. Friday's here, but Sunday's coming. It's like, wait till Sunday. And the Sunday might not take 3 days. It might take 30 days. It might take 30 months. I don't know. But Sunday is always coming. There's always a resurrection. There's always a resurrection. And He says this. He said, consider Him. Look at Jesus. Fix your eyes on Him. It says, consider Him who endured such opposition from sinners so that, say so that, you will not grow weary and lose heart. You see, when you grow weary, when you fished all night and you got weary and you want to quit and you want to give up and you want to think, man, this sucks. I've been trusting God for this healing for 8 years. Well, that's why in the Bible you'll see many times, and this woman was bent over by a spirit for 18 long years. The woman with issue of blood, she had spent all she had and just got worse. It gives you insight into people's personal troubles. They were personally in pain. They were desperate. And Jesus healed them all. And all of them got relief from their years and years of pain. That's who Jesus is. Come on. That's what I believe. That's what I believe. Holy. Galatians chapter 6 says this beautiful verse. He says, do not be deceived. Verse 7. God cannot be mocked. If you are deceived, you probably wouldn't know it. But don't. Stop it. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit, capital S, will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good. Say weary in doing good. You see, here's the repetition part. They were fished all night. They were just repeating all they knew what to do, and that was the right thing to do. You say, I've just been reading the Bible every day for 35 years. Yeah, just do it another day. I don't care. There's always life in the Word. There's always life in prayer. There's always life in worship. There's always life in fellowship. There's always life in communion. Every one of those elements, they're repetitive. They can look dull in themselves. They can look quite boring. But I tell you, every time something takes place, what is it? It's called sowing. You sow, you reap. Now, no farmer sows on Thursday, expects to reap on Friday. No one would do that. You see, I'm reaping today what I sowed last year. Because a farmer sows. But then the farmer doesn't go on holiday once he's finished sowing because he needs to tend his fields. He's got to go and make sure the fields are looked after, that there's no weeds, that there's no wild animals coming in, that the fences are intact. He might be fixing fences for a few weeks. He might be enclosing his paddock to make sure that whatever he's planted, whatever crop grows up nicely and strong, and he keeps the birds away. He puts up a scarecrow. It looks a bit like Daryl. He puts up a scarecrow. Come on. With hair. By faith. It says here, if we don't become weary in sowing, we will reap. We will reap. You see, sometimes you reap like amazing breakthrough. You think, oh, wow, what happened? Well, you were sowing for that for years. You just sowed and you sowed, and all of a sudden, bang, you get this amazing whooshka moment. But it didn't happen just like that. It happened actually through consistent perseverance. Sowing, because you will always reap when you sow. You will always reap. I remember sowing into many projects, and I was a bit like that kind of sensitive person that wants to give everything away. If you have money, you feel guilty that you got it, so you give it away. Empty your accounts. Don't show me your hands if you're one of those people. But that's the spirit of stupid. But the Lord can wink. It really is. It's like, hello. Every thousands of dollars. I don't know what we gave away. We gave away royalties. We sowed into nations. And some of it was just out of, we didn't want to actually have. We wanted to give it all away. Now that when you give everything away, then you become the need of someone else. Rather keep some. All right, unless the Lord spoke to you. But it wasn't God spoke to us. It's just that we had that in us. That's what we needed to do. It was part of the culture we grew up with. And it wasn't necessarily right. But the Lord said to me, I saw that. So you can feel like, oh, I've been ripped off. I gave that, and, you know, we gave to that building fund and they used the building for something else. Don't worry about it. You gave it to God. You gave it to Him. I didn't give it to the organization. The organization used it, but I gave it to God. And although I was a little bit giving out of guilt, God saw that and He's blessed that seed. I have been given, multiplied, pressed down, shaken together. God gives it back. He always gives it back. Always. It's the law. Sowing and reaping, sowing and reaping, sowing and reaping. Even stupid sowing can be reaped from. Just say, Lord, I just receive all the benefits of my stupid sowing. All right? Just pray that quick prayer and just receive it. I want us to just finish off with two scriptures. One is from 2 Chronicles 20. We know the story well. It's Jehoshaphat. And he's facing an army. He's facing not just one army, but he's facing the armies of the Midianites, the Amorites, the Korathites, and the Vegemites. All of them. All were there. And in verse 12, it says this, "We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you." We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. I love that. People come to me and they're like, Fini, you know, you're my pastor, and I got this issue, da-da-da-da, and they tell me the problem. And I'm like, I don't know. I said, but you have to know. You get paid to know. It's your job. So I'm like, no, I have no idea. I'm so sorry. I'll pray about it. I'll pray with you. I'll stand with you. But what you're going through, I have no idea. I've never seen someone go through this before, and I wish I had the answers. I feel your pain. I weep with you. I'll hold you. But I don't have the answer. You see, if we always feel we have to have the answers as Christians, we can be conned. Like, no, I don't know. People ask me big stories. I'm like, I'm as confused as you are. I have no idea. I think it's just honesty. Sometimes we feel like we've got to have the answers because God has all the answers. Well, he's got some of them because he hasn't given them all to me. Definitely he's keeping some to himself. there's some big questions about life which I haven't got the answers for. But I've seen him. I've felt him. He's loved me. He's communicated with me enough to know I'm on track. I'm not confused. I'm not in unbelief. I'm not wondering about the origins of the universe and you know, creation versus evolution and intelligent design. I'm absolutely convinced. You have to have a lot of faith to be an evolutionist. A lot of faith. It's big gaps in that theory. And they teach it as a fact. I tell my kids, because they have to learn it at school, I'm like, it's the theory of evolution? The theory? You know, if we evolved from apes, why are there still apes? Come on. Come on. Anyway. Some people need to evolve a bit more. Anyway. When people tell you, I believe in evolution, you say, well, what happened to you? Holy. Maybe don't say that. So they face this crisis and they really are up against it. They don't know what to do. And what do you do when you don't know what to do? Well, that's what this is going to answer, that question. Number one, they sought the Lord. They proclaimed a fast. He said, let's fast. Now, I don't proclaim fast lightly because I hate fasting. I prefer feasting, all right? I'd like to proclaim a feast. But on occasions, and the Lord will lead you, and I did one recently because I just felt I had to have a breakthrough in a certain area, I fasted. I didn't fast from coffee, but I fasted from everything else. But I fasted from food, and I sought the Lord. And that's what they did. They called a fast, and it says all of Israel and their little ones, the children, they got together, and they sought the Lord. Then Jehoshaphat stood up, and what did he do? He reminded them of all the works of God, all the mighty works of God. He said, this is the God who brought us out of this land. He killed our enemies. He brought us through the seas. He quenched the darkness. He brought us light. He did this and that. You see, because when you're facing a breakthrough, even if this is the breakthrough you need, you have to remind yourself of how good God is, number one, and that he has broken through in so many people's lives. So when you're having a breakthrough, you need a breakthrough. What are you going to do? Don't watch stupid television. That'll just feed your stupid brain with information you don't need. Feed your spirit with life-changing truth. Go on YouTube and find miracles and signs and TB Joshua and stuff. Watch tumors dissolving. Watch blind eyes opening. Watch deaf ears opening. Watch them again and again and again, because there's plenty of good news out there. Plenty of good news in here. Plenty of good news around. Fill your mind with good news. So to help Israel overcome their fear of defeat, he reminds them of who God is. The testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy. Every time I hear someone's story, a testimony, a breakthrough, I'm like, I'll take that. I'll take that. I don't need their breakthrough. I need my breakthrough. But I'll take that as a sign of God does breakthrough. God is faithful. And when they began, it says, and they began this weird process, they said, look, just stand your ground, because the battle is not yours, but God's. Some people can abdicate and say, well, that's mine. Then God will do it. Yeah, do it, God. No, they did do something. It says they raised their voices in a loud voice, and they began to worship God. And they sang this song, he is good, and his love endures forever. They sang a love song. How do we end up every Sunday, somewhere in the worship is like, his love endures forever. His love is for us. How high, how wide, how deep, how long? Why? Because does anybody know how much love we need? What makes you overcome in life? Love. If you're not loved, you just feel like not living. But when you're loved, you're like, whoa, I'm living the dream. Why? Because you're loved. A house can't make you feel loved. A car can't make you feel loved. Money can't make you feel loved. God can make you feel loved. And I can make you feel loved. Come on, it's true. You need God's love and you need someone's love. We need people love. We need to be fellowship with each other. And we need a hug. We need a someone to pray for us, someone to hold your hands. It's both. It's not either or. It's both and. We're connected to each other. But love is what is God is love. He sent Jesus to show us what love looks like. And he brought the breakthrough wherever he went. And God's got the breakthrough for you. So they sang the song. He is good. His love endures forever. And it says, and then the Lord, in verse 22, set ambushes. The Lord set ambushes. Say the Lord set ambushes. You see, we do what we can do. If we're called to fish, we're called to do our thing. We do what we can do. And then suddenly God does what he can do. And then you've been fishing all night, or you've been had this issue of blood all your life. All of a sudden, whooshka, the thing gets broken. The despair gets broken. You find yourself all of a sudden waking up and you're like, wow, I feel something's lifted. Well, yes, the Lord set an ambush against that assignment against your life. He set an assignment against your family. The Lord set an ambush. He ambushed them. They killed each other. All you did was stand. All you did was sing. All you did was say, God, I believe. I believe. Help my unbelief. All you did was be faithful. You kept your faithfulness to God. You said, Lord, you're my lover. I'm your wife. I'm your husband. You're my husband. We'll love you all the work of our days. And God set the ambush. God set the victory. God destroyed the enemy. That's what he does. He's good at that. I don't have to go around destroying enemies, looking for enemies. No. I'm going to lift my eyes to the hills where my help comes from. And when my help comes, you'll know it. When I've broken through, you'll know it. Breakthrough looks like something. You'll know it. Because many of you have broken through many areas of your life. And even if we haven't broken through in every area, when we've experienced an era of breakthrough, we think, ha ha, da 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 da. Like, woo, what are you talking about? Well, I've just broken through. And anyway, no, not yet. But I broke through that area, and that person broke through, and I saw them break through, and my turn's coming. You see, that's the attitude I have, because every breakthrough is a building of my faith. Every story is a story of faith, and it builds my faith and builds your faith. Who's going to say amen? Amen. Last story is 1 Samuel 30, and I'm done. How are you doing? Yes. Me too. Thanks for asking. 1 Samuel 30. Now, when David and his men came home from Ziklag on the third day, how many of you enjoy coming home? Been on a trip, been away, slept in weird beds, weird places, weird atmospheres. I was remembering this morning when I was in the 9 a.m. service that I've stayed in many countries and haven't always slept well. And one of the reasons was because when I was in Taiwan, I don't know what they did, but they just put me on this Hessian mat on concrete. That was the mattress. It was in a children's room, and I'm like, where's the bed? You know, this wouldn't even serve as a couch. It's not even a bench. It's like, and like the whole night, I'm like, you sit in the bed, nothing gives. Like, ooh. You get bruised just sitting down, you know. Anyway, I didn't sleep well. I think it was the opposite of hospitality should make people want to come back. I'm like, I want to leave. When can I go? And I was in Warrnambool once, and I had the opposite. I had this bed that sank in the middle, and Izzy and I met. We rolled down the sides and met in the middle. And I was clutching the edge, trying to pull myself out. I didn't sleep well there either. I haven't been back there either. But every time I come home, I love my bed. I got a great mattress. I sleep well every night at home. I sleep like boom, gone. Whole night, alarm goes off, I'm awake. Jing, jing. Hallelujah. And this is how David felt. He's coming home from a long battle. He's coming home to Ziklag. It's his home. That's where his bed is. That's where his family are. He's expecting children to run out. Daddy, daddy, woo. Nice to have you home. Except no one's there. And it's a distressing picture. It says that the Amalekites had made a raid on the south and on Ziklag. They had struck Ziklag and burned it with fire. So not only does he have a bed or a home, his house is burnt to the ground. It says they had taken the women and all who were there, both great and small, captive. They didn't kill anybody. I don't know if David knew that or not, but they were distressed. They came to the town. It was burned, and their wives and sons and daughters that were taken captive. Then David and the men with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more strength. How many of you heard a man weeping and it moves you because you think, man, men normally like, oh, I shed a tear. Let me not show anybody. Not me. I've managed to overcome that fear of showing emotion. But most men are not very emotional in public, certainly. You know, that wouldn't be the outward, especially warriors that kill people for a living. You know what I mean? They were weeping, wailing. Their wife and their children and their families were gone. Their houses were burned to the ground. They were wailing. Then the next thing is, and this is what often happens, we go through a difficult time, and it says, David was greatly distressed, for the men spoke of stoning him. Now, what did he have to do with that particular event? Was he not with them out in the battlefield doing God's work, trying to win the battle, and he was as much part of the trauma as they were? But so often we go through a trauma, whose fault is it? It's going to be someone's fault. Let me tell you, I'll tell you who it is. It's not your family, it's not your neighbor, it's not your boss, it's not someone in authority, it's not somebody who stole your money, it's the devil.
Yes.
Come on. Don't blame a person. Don't find some individual and think, yeah, we're going to stone you. It's your fault. You're the reason why I haven't been happy. You're the reason why I haven't got any money. You're the reason why I'm not fruitful. No, don't be ridiculous. God is bigger than the person that actually caused you to lose the money or lose the influence that you had. The issue is, let's get it back. It's not whose fault it was that took it. How do we get it back? That's the issue. And so it says that David was distressed. He was distressed as they were, but he didn't just stay there. He didn't just stay bitter and twisted and say, yeah, what's this stuff with serving God? This thing sucks. I'm the psalmist after God's own heart. I've killed a lion and a bear, and now even my wife's gone. Lord, where the hell were you? What's going on? Well, it can get like that. You can feel like, I've served you all my life. Oh, come on, I lost my money. It's not fair. Of course it's not fair. Let me tell you right now, life is not fair. But I got faith for breakthrough and for finance and for miracles and for healing and for deliverance for everybody. Why? Because that's the nature of God. And David didn't allow himself the luxury of self-pity. And then he didn't start squabbling. Hey, what's going on? What's your problem? You think it's my fault? Do I look like a Malachite? Do I look like a Midianite? He could have done that. He could have, like, I've lost my wife as well. I'll kill you first. And you start to squabble. So the issue was not the people in front of him. He understood. These guys are just talking out of their pain. Sometimes we take people's pain seriously. They're just talking out of pain. Just let it go right to the keeper. Let it go through.
Yes.
Don't take it personally. He didn't take it personally, but he did do something. This is what we've got to do, each of us. He encouraged and strengthened himself.
Yes.
Say encouraged.
Encouraged.
And strengthened.
Strengthened.
Himself.
In the Lord.
Wow. How do you do that? No idea. I've no idea how you do it. I know how I do it. But I don't want to put that on you. But I know when I haven't done it. And I know when I haven't got it. And I know when my head's low. I know when I'm dragging my feet. And no one can strengthen you in your God. No one can pat you on the back and say, there, you poor thing. Oh, you've lost your little money. You've lost all your time. You poor thing. No, that's just like Job's friends. They're like, curse God and die. What did you do? You see, if you want to compare yourself to Job, firstly, become the wealthiest man in the eastern suburbs. All right? It says there, in the east. He was the wealthiest man in the whole of the east. So he was the wealthiest man in the whole of the eastern suburbs. Come on. And then for a short period of his life, a couple of years, maybe half a decade, he lost influence, money, children. He had a great loss. But the whole book of Job is about the loss. Whereas most of his life, he was the wealthiest man in the East, had wives and children and flocks and herds and lived well. He was a man of righteousness, an upright man. Amen.
Yes.
And then at the very end, it says, and he got everything back twice as much. So if you want to compare your life to Job, get more than anybody has already, lose it, and get it back twice as much, then come back to me, all right? Until that time, focus on the first chapter and the last chapter. Amen. Come on. So David goes to God and says, God, what must I do? Must I chase them? Must I go back? Will I get them back? He says, chase them, you'll get it all back. He chases them, he gets them all back, plus they spend 3 days. They get all the other booty from other stuff. So, you see, you can suffer loss, you can suffer deprivation, you can suffer despair, but if you don't lose your faith, if you don't lose your hope, if you do everything you can to stand and you still stand, then you get what you lost and you get more. You get more, come on. You get more. You get more. God restored everything they lost and they got more. Whatever those enemies had been raiding other people's towns and villages, they got all their livestock as well. That's the way God is. That's how you reap where you haven't sown. Don't stop sowing, but you're going to reap even where you haven't sown. You're like, wow, how did I get that influence? How did I get that promotion? How did I get that money? You just reap where you haven't sown. Just go, ha, 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 thank you, Lord. Love it. Love it. Love it. Just love it. Oh, Lord, what is this so good? Father, I thank you for every faithful person in this church. All the Abrahams and Isaacs, people who've stood for decades. Sometimes, some of them have stood for decades for things they haven't yet seen. And I thank you, Father, that their names, if we were rewriting the Bible today, their names would be in Hebrews 11 in the Hall of Faith. The Hall of Fame. The Hall of faithful people who believed God. But Lord, we also pray for breakthrough today. You're saying to us, even in that prophetic word, that vision that we had, Tanya had, is that we're going to see miracles today in spines, in lungs, in hips, in finances, in feeding, in manna, and things that she didn't even say, but we just know there's a proliferation of body parts that people need today, 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 today. And I just say, Lord, today, we're going to let, even though we've fished all night, we're going to let down our nets again. We're going to let them down again. We're going to be again Christians. We're going to do the things that we did before again and again and again and again and again and again. And while your head's about, if you are here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord, I said you need to have him in your boat to receive these promises I've spoken of today. And only you can invite him in. No one can do it for you. You can't. There's no grandchildren of God. They're all children. And they became children by making that choice and by inviting him in, by hearing the knocking on the door and opening the door and letting him come in. And if you're today here and you say, I don't know that, Jesus. I haven't yet had my sins forgiven. I still feel I'm on the outside. Won't you raise your hand where you are and say, Finn, I'd love to be saved today. I want to know this Jesus. Just where I can see it, just put up your hand boldly. Thank you. I see your hand. Is anybody else? Anybody else want to say yes to Jesus? Holy, just put up your hand where I can see it, then put it down again. We're not going to embarrass you or call you to the front, but you have to position yourself for salvation. You have to position yourself for the kingdom of heaven to break in. Thank you, Lord. Well, we're going to put some worship music on now and pray for people. I'd love to, if you have children in the kids ministry, why don't you just go and sign them out? And even if they do, you want ministry, just sign them out first and bring them back in, just because we want to give the teachers some relief at this point. And so do that, but please stay. And I want to encourage you, if any of those words of knowledge that Tanya was prophesying about was for you, please slip out of your chair straight away, come down to the front. And also, if you have had thoughts of death, thoughts of suicide, thoughts of that thought is not me. Well, I want to say to you, it's not you. That's what struggling and wrestling looks like. It's thoughts. And if you've been assailed by thoughts, they're not your thoughts. We want to pray that assignment of evil will be broken and you'll be free of those thoughts. Does that make sense? So if that's part of you, it could be emotional, whatever it is, you just come forward. The team will pray for you. We're going to have amazing breakthroughs today. Amen. Let's thank the Lord.